Welcome everyone to today's presentation entitled Russia-Ukraine Crisis, Continued Diplomatic Standoff, and a Looming Invasion. Today's presenter is Maia Otarashvili. Maia is a research fellow and deputy director of the Eurasia Program and serves as the deputy director of research at the Foreign Policy Research Institute in Philadelphia. She is co-editor of FPRI's 2017 volume, Does Democracy Matter? The United States and Global Democracy Support. Her research interests include geopolitics and security of the Black Sea Caucasus region, Russian foreign policy, and the post-Soviet conflicts. Maia is a PhD candidate at the War Studies Department at King's College in London, and she holds a master's in globalization, development, and transition from the University of Westminster in London, with an emphasis on post-authoritarian transitions. Today's topic obviously is very, very timely in terms of what is going on with Russia and the Ukraine. So with no further ado, I turn things over to Maia. Welcome.
Thank you very much. Thank you, David. Thank you to the World Affairs Council of Reading for inviting me today. Thank you for taking interest in this really important issue at the moment. As David said, we'll be talking about the Russia-Ukraine tensions. I can see a great turnout. I'm sure so many of you are worried about it, but I want to dial back a little bit and put this in the context, sort of chronological order of events, because this didn't start just a month ago or 2 months ago or whenever CNN started covering it. April 2022 is actually going to mark 8 years since the Russia-backed separatist conflict broke out in eastern Ukraine in Donbas. And just a year before that, Russia had annexed the Crimea Peninsula, Ukraine's Crimea Peninsula. It's an illegal annexation. I'm sure most of you are aware of these things, but the war in Donbas, according to CFR's global conflict tracker, the war in Donbas has so far produced 10,000 civilian casualties, 1.5 million people have been displaced, and the overall casualty numbers are estimated at about 14,000. And despite multiple ceasefire agreement attempts, here we are almost 8 years in, and this war is unresolved, greatly thanks to Russia's backing of these separatist movements. So that's kind of the backdrop of the situation. Now let's go back to April of last year of 2021, when Russia began building up its troops and heavy military artillery in Crimea and on its borders with Ukraine. Russia placed about 100,000 soldiers on the border with Ukraine. Again, that's April of last year. I'm not talking about this current buildup. And Russia began carrying out military exercises. Of course, the Ukrainian President Zelensky was outraged, so were many Western experts, and Zelensky went on this major tour trying to garner Western support, saying that another invasion was clearly looming, and he wanted more help from NATO and EU, but most importantly, he wanted President Biden to become more involved in this, and he wanted more backing from President Biden. As we know, President Biden has been a big supporter of NATO and sort of carrying out foreign policy, U.S. foreign policy through a collaboration with allies. So that's what President Biden did. Tony Blinken went to Brussels on April 14th, to rally up NATO member states and EU member states. So there was, this buildup of alarm and outrage and calls on Russia to de-escalate. And that seemed to work. Putin got what he wanted in the moment, it seemed, which was to get a call from President Biden, and he did. And then, you know, the Russian Ministry of Defense said, oh, this was just a military exercise, and we are, you know, we're done with the military exercise now. So he called the troops back. However, and, you know, we have to keep an eye on this, most of the equipment and most of the artillery was left behind. So then, you know, fast forward a couple months ahead, there is, you know, another NATO summit where, you know, there are all these strong messages of support coming out of NATO for Ukraine, for NATO's Eastern allies, the non-member states who have this aspiration to join NATO. NATO says very clearly, you know, we're not currently giving a membership, a path to membership to Ukraine and Georgia. There's no promise of this, or there's no membership partnership act. They call it a map, but, you know, these are our partner countries. We respect their aspiration to join NATO, and we're going to, you know, keep on working with them to support them, support their, you know, reforms in their defense sector. Our door, our open door policy is going to stand, and we, you know, condemn Russia's actions in the Black Sea region. And we also call on Russia to withdraw from Crimea. So that was the summer, and parallel to this, Moscow carried out a joint military exercise with Belarus called Zapad exercises, which it regularly does jointly with Belarus. They did this in mostly in the eastern parts of Belarus and also on the Baltic Sea. We all know about the current tensions, but before I go into that, I want to point out something really, really important. I get this question a lot. I see this question all over the internet. You know, what does Putin really want? You know, what is he trying to accomplish in Ukraine, or what does he want for Russia, so on and so forth? It's actually you know, not that much of a mystery, and he usually, you know, talks very openly about the things he wants, his aspirations for Russia. And I thought this op-ed that he published back in like July the 12th, you know, it's not really an op-ed. It's this like long manifesto of him going into this kind of a deranged narrative where he kind of rewrites the history of Russia and Ukraine and Europe. It's 42 paragraphs long, but it offers so much insight into essentially how emotional he is about Ukraine and how hung up he is on Ukraine. In this op-ed, he talks about things like, you know, the Western puppeteers have come to take over Ukraine. The Ukrainian government does not speak for itself. He talks a lot about the Bolshevik Revolution as well. It's this long deranged thing that he published, and he does this sometimes. But this one in particular was super emotional about Ukraine. So he says that, you know, in this diatribe, he says that step by step, Ukraine was dragged into a dangerous geopolitical game aimed at turning Ukraine into a barrier between Europe and Russia, a springboard against Russia. Inevitably, there came a time when the concept of Ukraine is not Russia was no longer an option. There was a need for the anti-Russia concept. And he says, we will never accept this concept that Ukraine is not only Ukraine is not Russia, but it's anti-Russian. And then he talks about how in Donbas, you know, Kiev has neglected Donbas, this breakaway region, that Kiev simply does not need Donbas. Why? Because firstly, the inhabitants of these regions will never accept the order that they have tried and are trying to impose by force, blockade, and threats. He accuses the West of essentially using the government in Ukraine as its puppet. And he says things like, we're facing the creation of a climate of fear in Ukrainian society, aggressive rhetoric, indulging neo-Nazis and militarizing the country. Along with that, we're witnessing not just complete dependence, but direct external control and supervision of Ukrainian authorities. And the way he sort of lays out, you know, his solutions for this are, you know, I cannot talk to the Ukrainian government because the Ukrainian government does not speak on behalf of itself or on behalf of the Ukrainian people. He says that this is this anti-Russia project. There's no place either for sovereign Ukraine or for the political forces that are trying to defend Ukraine's real independence. So this was just such a chilling, you know, thing to read back in July. And most of us, you know, were alarmed. I remember back then I wrote, you know, this is for him an excuse for aggression and meddling in Ukraine. So, you know, we need to keep an eye on this because essentially he was justifying a looming invasion of Ukraine to essentially free Ukraine from these Western puppeteers and to reunite the peoples of Russia and Ukraine, which again, in his long op-ed, he describes as one people and there should be no separation between the two. A lot of these things, a lot of his statements, a lot of his writings, right? They're filled with cynicism very often because he's talking about the human rights conditions in the undisputed Ukrainian territories, how regular Ukrainians are so fearful of the government and how oppressed they are. Yet we have dozens of reports about human rights conditions, right? Not just in Russia, but in Russian occupied Crimea, where freedom of expression is not really an option and dissent can get you thrown in jail and can get you in trouble. And Donbas too, the breakaway region of Donbas is essentially no man's land. And, you know, it's mired in chaos. These are, you know, this is not speculation. We have studies and plenty of data and anecdotal evidence to back this up, right? So the idea of the poor oppressed Ukrainians that Putin tries to sort of introduce is just this continuation of the kind of cynicism that we're used to seeing come out of a lot of Russian officials, not just Putin, but certainly Putin. So then, you know, fast forward to late fall of 2021, when we see renewed military buildup. Again, a lot of the artillery was already left there. So we started seeing, you know, Moscow send troops back to Crimea, to most of the flashpoints of its border with Ukraine, and to the north of Ukraine, to the north of Kiev in Belarus. So this is another sort of major game changer, right? Because this did not used to be the case before, but since the military exercises that Russia had in Belarus this past summer, and since, you know, Lukashenko's sort of a more greater embrace of Russian military presence in Belarus, now Putin has been able to essentially encircle Ukraine with its military presence. And the buildup started in the fall. I believe, you know, just back in January, we were at 100,000 troops, but now we are well over 130,000 troops, Russian troops stationed at the borders with Ukraine. According to the latest reports, Russia has 70% of the number of troops it needs in order to invade Ukraine overnight. So this is a quite a dire situation, but unlike what it did in April, Moscow this time, when it started this buildup, you know, massing the forces in the fall, just came out and said it straight up. we are doing this not as a military exercise, but we're doing this as a measure to defend ourselves because we feel threatened by NATO and by the United States. We feel threatened by NATO's Eastern forward presence, and we want certain guarantees. We want NATO to guarantee that it will never let Ukraine come and join its ranks, that it will not expand to the east to include, you know, Ukraine, Georgia. We want NATO to sign a treaty that we have just drafted and published. And that treaty essentially would acknowledge and formalize Russia's monopoly over essentially most of the former Soviet Union, and would formalize this idea of Russia having a sphere of influence. This would no longer be an idea. This would be something that the West would acknowledge, and by signing this treaty. Again, right, they just sort of draft this treaty and publish it, and then they just expect NATO to sign it. Obviously, things didn't go as well, and the Western allies have been looking for a diplomatic solution. They have explained very clearly to Moscow that there will be NATO's open door policy is between NATO and the aspirant member countries, and that it is not for third parties like Russia to determine whether NATO expands or not, whether, you know, Ukraine joins the European Union, NATO, you know, what it does with its own sort of military capabilities. So, despite the fact that, you know, NATO and the US haven't been willing to negotiate on NATO's open door policy, they've been engaging very actively and still believe that there is a diplomatic solution here. How possible this diplomatic solution is, that's what's become the big debate in Washington, but also amongst the you know, Ukraine watchers and Russia watchers. So the camp is really divided right now. There are two groups. One, mostly made up of the military analysts, Western military analysts, particularly people in Washington, who believe that an invasion is forthcoming. A couple of days ago, I heard, oh, it's going to happen on February 12th. And the debate is about what kind of a Russian invasion is coming to Ukraine. Is it going to be something a bit more stealth, maybe little bits of skirmishes, or is it going to be just a full-scale invasion going straight for Kyiv? But the second group of people that I often speak to say that it would be too expensive for Moscow to invade Ukraine, to go for this full-scale invasion, especially given the kinds of financial sanctions that the West, and particularly again the United States, has been promising. Anything from sanctioning Putin personally and going after his personal wealth to removing Russia from the international SWIFT system, which would debilitate the Russian economy. On the other hand, you know, as this buildup has continued, what I find very interesting is that, again, since 2015, the US has been quite reluctant to militarily support Ukraine. It was not until President Trump's sort of latter years, maybe year three, when the US first started selling weapons to Ukraine. But until that point, the US had kind of tried to stay out of this and be mostly involved militarily. Now we hear statements like, we are prepared for anything, right? If you watch any of the press conferences, whether it's President Biden or Secretary of State Blinken, they say, we're looking for a diplomatic solution. We support Ukraine's independence. We believe there's a diplomatic solution here, but we are prepared for anything. And we've seen NATO, as well as the United States, back that rhetoric up with action. They have been sending more troops to the eastern flank of NATO. They've been arming Ukraine, and they've been sending a lot of military aid. I mean, the news of this, you know, it would be sort of hard to go over just how much military aid Ukraine has received over the past few months from various countries, independent sort of individual member states of NATO, and then overall sort of the NATO aid. But, you know, obviously the question is still, would the West ever be willing to sort of go toe-to-toe with Russia and actually put troops in Ukraine? I think everyone is trying to avoid that at the moment. So, you know, hopefully that won't be a question, that won't be a bridge that we actually have to cross. I know I've been speaking for a while, so let me just make a few more points, and then, you know, we can go into Q&A. I have quite a few things that, you know, I can mention sort of later, maybe in the discussion, but there are a few factors to discuss here. So first of all, the idea that since President Macron went to Moscow just a couple of days ago, now we are hearing President Putin speak about the Minsk Accords. So the Minsk agreements were the initial ceasefire agreements, Minsk 1 and Minsk 2, that were negotiated in Belarus. Ukraine, Germany, France, Russia are all involved in this. And those are the ceasefire agreements that never really held in Donbas because shelling has continued. But Putin has sort of gone back and forth about Minsk. And until recently, those negotiations were essentially dead because Putin kept saying that Zelensky needed to negotiate directly with the leaders of the breakaway territories of the de facto state of Donbas. And he insisted that it was for, the conversation was not one to be had between him and Zelensky. Zelensky had to talk to the people in Donbas. And Zelensky was trying to bring in the United States to be more involved in the Minsk negotiations. Minsk 1 and 2 are not popular domestically in Ukraine to begin with, because essentially it involves giving a certain degree of autonomy to Donbas. And that is not something that most Ukrainians support. Now, since Macron's visit, you know, Putin is talking about Minsk again, the Minsk agreements again, but the trouble is all in the interpretation of what's in the Minsk agreement. Because according to Ukraine, it's seen as a ceasefire agreement between Ukraine and Russia. And it does speak about giving certain autonomy to Donbas, but it would certainly stay within Ukraine. However, the way Russia sees the Minsk agreements is that Ukraine would give autonomy to Donbas, and then the leadership in Donbas would have a veto power on most major decisions that the Ukrainian government would make, and would have veto power, most importantly, on Ukraine's foreign policy decisions, i.e. Russia controls the government in Donbas, and the government in Donbas vetoes Ukraine's any decision Ukraine might make to join NATO, join the EU, or allow any permanent military presence, Western military presence. So this is the trouble with Minsk. This is the trouble with a lot of these agreements, ceasefire agreements or negotiations with Russia, whether that is over, you know, breakaway territories, Transnistria, you know, Abkhazia, South Ossetia, Donbas, or just in general, when you speak to Russia, right? The interpretation of reality, it seems like there are always two realities. And one is the way Russia sees things, and the other is the way the West sees things. So it's very frustrating. The negotiation process is always very frustrating. And this is something I can tell you that the Georgians have been dealing with for a really long time, since 2008, when Russia invaded Georgia. So the issue is not, and it is an issue, the fact that the Ukrainians don't support the Minsk Accords to begin with. But even if Zelensky was to garner domestic support for giving some kind of an autonomy to Donbass. Then you go to the negotiating table and you know, Moscow says, well, this is the kind of autonomy that you agreed to, which again gives veto power on foreign policy decisions to a government in Donbass. And so then there's just a fundamental disagreement on basic realities of what's written in black and white in these agreements. I don't know if I should stop here. Maybe I can stop here. There are a couple of things I wanted to mention, but maybe I can mention those in the discussion.
We are starting to get a bunch of questions in, so maybe it is a good break point. We can get Stalin to make a couple of quick announcements. I'll ask some questions, and hopefully we can get to the rest of your points as we go Great. Through this next half hour to 45 minutes here.
Great.
Saul?
Hey. Thank you, Mike. Thank you, Maia. Very, very interesting, and I know we'll get a lot more detail and depth as you proceed. Upcoming for us, February 23, we have a journey of heart and soul across Spain with John Gallen, a Berks County businessman, very much respected. And his perspective on this journey is going to be how in that traveling through this area across Spain actually leads in some ways to some better international understanding. That's John's perspective, and you'll find him very engaging. We do have an update on what had been planned for March 2, with Stephanie Foster on fighting for women and girls. She has a conflict with that date, so we're going to have to look to reschedule that, likely still in March at some point. Coming up April 13, the immigration crisis in Europe, the case of Spain, presented by Laura Lopez Calon, and she's a visiting instructor of Spanish at Albright College. I think we'll find her interesting. And as we've been saying, we're very happy to have a just about to be a college graduate. In fact, he will be a graduate of Penn State at the point of his presentation. This is James Garrett on speaking in Qatar, where he spent some time under the auspices of a grant with the World Affairs Council of America. You'll find him, I think, very engaging. We've had several conversations with him. Keep in the back of your mind the possibility of a forum, a panel discussion with Representative Dan Musser and Representative Christy Houlihan, both of whom represent Berks County in the U.S. Congress, large parts of us, very small section otherwise represented, also both sit on the House Foreign Affairs Committee. I was able to speak with Representative Musser this morning for a good half hour. I think this is going to be happening, and the question now will be the date and whether Congresswoman Houlihan can join in on it, but I think she will. So those are some possible and set and possible upcoming events. Thank you.
Thank you, Saul. Okay, so excellent presentation so far. We've got some questions coming in. So I think I'm just going to start with, I have some of my own questions, but I think I'll just start with our member questions as they've been written, because there is a lot of interest in this. So we'll start with Joseph McDevitt. He asks, is this the start of empire building in Russia? And I guess I imagine like, there's probably a broader context to empire building in Russia. Maybe this isn't the beginning of it. So what can you add any context there?
Yeah, these are great questions. And thank you for sending those in. So Russia has been an empire forever and ever, right? For a really long time. So you have to think about a leader like Putin, who, yes, he's a kleptocrat. And I've heard, who was it? I think it was David Satter who said, the Russian leadership imagine thugs with foreign policy, right? So it's interesting, the combination of personal wealth interests, but also there's an ideology. There's a greater ideology that the Russian people have in general, right? This aspiration that Russia is a rightful great power, rightful global great power. So whether that is before the Soviet Union as the Russian Empire or during the Soviet Union. I'm sure many of you have heard that, you know, early on when Putin became a president, he said that it was, you know, one of the greatest tragedies of the century was the fall of the Soviet Union. But he has become over time more and more inspired by this idea that, you know, Russia should have this rightful regional domination. And then if you want to put it in more sort of technical terms, what he has, what he sees as Russia's security, is this idea that it needs a buffer zone. Russia has to have a buffer zone between itself and the West, so that the West is not so uncomfortably close. So if Ukraine joins, you know, NATO, then NATO borders Russia a lot more. So there's that idea of wanting a physical buffer zone. But now, you know, in the recent decade, longer decade than a decade, he has taken that to a next level. He doesn't just want a buffer zone now. Now he wants this kind of expansion of power and control. And this is absolutely not the beginning of this. Most people mark, you know, Russia's decision to invade Georgia in this five-day war in August of 2008 as the beginning of Russia's sort of direct aggressive behavior. But actually, if you look at the region right now, and I sent some links for maps, and I think, you know, maps just are so helpful in visualizing these things. If you look at the region, if you look at the former Soviet Union, you know, around Russia, right now, and I hate using this term about Russia, but Russia has positioned itself as the security provider in the region. And again, what I don't see it as a security provider. Most of us in the West see it as a threat. It sees itself as a security provider and uses that terminology. So you look at Georgia, Abkhazia, South Ossetia, both border Russia to breakaway territories. Russia has placed permanent military missions in both of those spaces. It calls them peacekeepers. Just over a year ago, there was an active war between Armenia and Azerbaijan in the South Caucasus over Nagorno-Karabakh. Russia brokered a ceasefire agreement and placed a military peacekeeping mission there. You have Transnistria, Moldova, on the other side of the Black Sea, another breakaway region where Russia has permanent military presence. Crimea. There's a huge military presence there. And again, especially right now, Donbas, Russia militarily supports it. Now Russia has made these brand new military alliances with Belarus. So there's Russian military presence there. Just in early January, in Kazakhstan, there was an uprising that tried to overthrow the government. And the president of Kazakhstan, Tokayev, called on the Collective Security Treaty Organization, which is led by Russia, and it involves a handful of former Soviet Union member countries, called on them to come and help because, quote unquote, they were being invaded by terrorists. So these you know, the people who wanted to overthrow the government, you know, immediately Tokayev called them terrorists. There's no evidence of this kind of, you know, of terrorists there, but that's what he said it was. Put the country on red alert. Overnight, Russia organized a military mission to Kazakhstan. 25,000 troops, mostly Russian. Yes, there were some Armenian ones, but mostly Russian. Right. So that's Kazakhstan. So if you look at the map, you look at the region, you think about Russia's not just political influence, not just Russia's sort of alliances there, but now these hard power military sort of influences that it has, it's really hard to look away, right? And I'm not even going to go into the fact that, you know, Russia is involved in Syria and Yemen and sends the Wagner Group to various places in Africa and has military alliances with China and is a great friend with Turkey, right? So this is absolutely not the beginning of you know, Russia's posturing as this great power player, an empire, but this is a major move. It is an attempt to consolidate what Putin started a while ago.
You had started your presentation by saying Putin's not hard to figure out. Like, we understand his motives, right? And one of the things that stood out to me as you were doing your presentation was you talked about how they claimed they felt threatened by the US and by NATO. And part of what they were looking for was assurances. But here again, we see it's really just about expansion. This is all a cover, right? So a question from Christian Leinbach. I have family that lives on the eastern Slovak border with Ukraine, about 12 miles from the border. They are very concerned that they will be next if Russia invades or takes over Ukraine. How real are those fears?
Yeah, that's a great question. So Slovakia, an EU member country, NATO member country, it's easier to mess with Ukraine because it's not a member of NATO. The Baltic members of NATO, of course, are also very concerned about this kind of a physical threat from Russia. I would start with the fact that people in Ukraine, the mood in Ukraine is very interesting right now. First of all, they've been living in war conditions for almost 8 years now. So this is nothing new to them. Two, apparently, you know, a lot of my colleagues I speak to, there's this eerie calm in Ukraine. People either do not believe that, you know, there will be a full-out invasion, but also those who expect the invasion, for example, they're not stocking up on food, they're not panicking, they're not running in the streets and, you know, emptying out stores, nothing like that. And again, they just keep saying, you know, if it happens, we'll just cross that bridge when we come to it. And also, there's a great deal of trust. The Ukrainian people have a great deal of confidence in their military, and surveys show that their confidence levels in the military seem to be increasing. And I think a lot of that has to do with the fact that the West has chosen to start arming Ukraine and support it militarily. So, I don't have my mind made up. My every hope is that Ukraine will not be engaged in this kind of a full-out war, and that yes, there is a stopping point to all of this. It very much depends on how Western posturing, if you ask me. But I would say, you know, I cannot see Moscow invading a NATO member country, an EU member country like Slovakia. You know, there's a lot more to play with before you actually go full out to sort of, because if you invade a NATO member country, then the Article 5, then there is no more question. Do we respond or not, right? Because the Article 5 immediately becomes activated. And this is one of the reasons why Russia does not want Ukraine to join NATO. So the Article 5 is the biggest thing that everybody wants from NATO, which is a collective security, right? So an attack on one of us is an attack on all of us. You attack one NATO member country, that means that you've attacked all of us. So we will all then militarily respond, right? So that's a major, major security guarantee that Ukraine has been desperately seeking for a really long time, and so is Georgia. So that's what Slovakia has, is what Russia has been trying to avoid for Ukraine.
So when we deal with Ukraine, we deal with them as a country with respect to this Article 5 protection with the UN. That's kind of the category that they want to get themselves in. But within Ukraine, my understanding is that there's a lot of division. In the north, they identify more with Russia and are much more supportive. In the south, they identify much more with Europe and want to stay away from Russia. How does that dynamic come into play with the internal reaction that you just described?
Yeah, I think it's really important to underline that, right? Ukraine is a very large country, and it's very diverse. There are plenty of sort of Russian-speaking Ukrainians, ethnically Russian Ukrainians. There's plenty of sort of German influence there as well. So, you know, no one is dismissing the fact that Ukraine is very large and diverse, and one person's preference does not speak for everybody. There is also this major division actually between sort of these Western Kyiv elites and then everybody else, right? And the everybody else is dealing with things like poverty. Again, 1.4 million internally displaced people from the war in Donbas. Ukraine, you know, is not the most prosperous country. It has a lot of economic struggles. And again, when you've been at war for 8 years, just the impact of that, right? So you do hear this very often where, you know, Ukrainians, regular Ukrainians, you know, farther away from Kiev, they're like, well, we're less worried about the war and we're more worried about, you know, hunger, about stability. And yeah, in terms of how they ethnically identify, though, that does not mean that, you know, Ukraine tomorrow will turn into, you know, 10 different countries given the option. Donbas was one of the most sort of ethnically, right, more there were more Russian, ethnic Russians there. And those were the differences, right, that Moscow exploited to help spark the separatist conflict that we have going on there. But overall, you know, Ukraine, even without Russia, even without the territorial integrity issues, Ukraine has a lot of problems. There is, you know, this issue with oligarchs, kleptocracy, you know, economic development, political stability. So yeah, I mean, it's not, you know, Ukraine is and was even a bigger basket case, I think, before Zelensky came around. It's still undergoing a lot of economic reforms, governance reforms, but there is still so much more work to be done. So it's a huge challenge, and it's a huge challenge to the European security architecture as well. If you were a stable, consolidated democracy that had a prosperous economy, and you were dealing with what's happening with Russia right now, that would be a challenge. But then you add these domestic challenges, and it's a real issue. You're muted.
I just got on the internet, so still learning how these things work, obviously. I think just adding, as we can even see as a good case study here at home, countries are not monoliths, right? We have a lot of different opinions here. Bernard Gerber had asked about Donbas, but I think that was before you started talking about it. So I think we've covered that pretty well. Bill Thomas, I think this kind of goes to a lot of the stuff we've been talking about, but anything specific come to mind if you think about the realities of internal politics, ethnic cultural differences between Ukraine and Russia that have been primary drivers here?
Yeah, well, this is the funny thing. I had a conversation with a colleague recently, and we were saying how if Russia was not, you know, if Putin and the government in Moscow was not so aggressively, you know, you're with us or against us, and if there is no, you know, if Russia had not taken this kind of an aggressive foreign policy towards the former Soviet states, there would probably be a lot of harmony and friendship, right? Because there are plenty of Ukrainians, just like Georgians or anyone else, right? They have this great history of you know, being, whether it was part of the Soviet Union or part of the Russian Empire before that, whether you like it or not, right? There's friendship, there's connection, there are families that are on both sides of these borders, right? They're regular people who would like access, things as simple as, you know, when Moscow kicked out most U.S. diplomats and America had to shut down most of its consulates in Russia, you know, Russians started flying to Kiev to go for their visa appointments to the American embassy and get their visas, right? Why did, you know, Putin annex Crimea? Because it was the top vacation destination for Russians. And so there is, you know, for the regular people, you know, there's a lot of connection and friendship, of course. And, you know, we cannot avoid that. You know, if most Ukrainians had their choice, right, they would have an open relationship with Russia. They would go back and forth freely. Again, many of them have families there. So no one is dismissing that, right? Sadly, I think this is the problem. If Putin really believed in this great connection between the Russians and the Ukrainians, he wouldn't be doing what he's doing, because he's actually setting these nations apart and creating the kind of isolation that will then take generations to undo in peacetime. So again, I think this is where I keep going back to this idea of cynicism, right? Because you're unless you're just, you know, being cynical about this, if the two nations really do belong together this much, maybe, you know, don't threaten to invade it, right?
A question from a longtime board member, multiple time presenter to the World Affairs Council, professor here at Penn State Berks, Randy Newnham. Macron was reported as speaking of Finlandization of Ukraine as an option. Does this show the West may essentially give in here, accepting that Ukraine will have to stay neutral?
Yeah, so during the Cold War, Finland, remained strictly neutral. And that's what they mean by Finlandization of Ukraine. So essentially, and Macron, after he visited Putin, I don't know if you guys saw this very long table, and both of them, sort of Putin and Macron, sitting on either side of that table. It was kind of comical. People keep making fun of Macron for going to Ukraine, for going to Moscow and speaking to Putin and seeking a diplomatic solution. But, because then when he left Moscow, he said, I think I got Putin to agree to de-escalate. And, we still don't quite know what the outcome was, but, he tried to find, again, just continued this Western position of seeking a diplomatic solution. And it was after that that Macron said, Finlandization of Ukraine is not off the table. But I think that kind of shows you a little bit of this, I wouldn't call it a rift, but yeah, there is this thing within the NATO member states. Germany has been an outlier for a really long time. Germany has been the least supportive of Ukraine's and Georgia's NATO accession, for example. Germany has been, more sort of empathetic, I guess, towards Russia's position. And often we've seen France do something similar. So I think maybe this is why people were not so happy to see Macron go. And then when he, comes back from Moscow and he says something like Finlandization of Ukraine, well, the trouble with that is that it would guarantee, again, that NATO would not absorb Ukraine. One thing is neutrality, right? Military neutrality, but what it implies goes back to what Moscow is looking for, right? Which is for NATO to guarantee that it will not absorb Ukraine. NATO is a security alliance, right? So you cannot be neutral and be a part of NATO. That's just not, you have to choose one or the other. So Macron is wrong in that, he's not conveying the official stance of NATO on Ukraine. But again, I think it just tells you a little bit about maybe some of the internal conversations that are happening inside NATO. Again, I don't think that Germany would be that opposed if the NATO leadership came out and said, yeah, we're not going to, we're going to change our open door policy. So I think that's what it implies. But again, I do not see the United States or, overall the top NATO leadership in Brussels walking back on one of the founding principles of NATO, which is this open door policy. The negotiations about NATO accession are between NATO and the aspirant member country. By the way, just so our audience members can have some background, when NATO was established, Putin was actually, supportive of Russia's Western integration. We're talking about the 90s now. And later on, there was a NATO body formed called the NATO-Russia Council, the NRC. Since the annexation of Crimea, the NRC has been put on hold. But even in sort of the 2000s, there were regular meetings, confidence-building meetings between the NATO leadership and Russian delegations about deconflicting, again, about confidence building and about sort of achieving a meaningful alliance between NATO and Russia. Now, the NRC has been essentially defunct for quite a few years because of what Russia did with Ukraine, but the NATO leadership continues to propose this. Let's revive the NRC. Let's start having dialogues, confidence building dialogues between Russia and NATO through the NATO-Russia Council. And Russia just refuses to do that because then, if they do start having these conversations and if they do start having, diplomatic interactions, then Russia won't have this excuse of NATO is this murky, you know, sort of evil thing that threatens Russia's national security, because that's the big boogeyman right now that, you know, Putin can keep referring back to as he keeps on threatening Ukraine.
And this issue of Ukraine's membership in NATO may well not be settled by the time Russia invades, if that happens. Dave Carroll asks, what would likely be the response from NATO and the U.S.? Is the U.S. committed to defending Ukraine either way, or what? Yeah. How do you imagine that would play out?
That's a good question. So no, the U.S. is not legally, right? So essentially, if you're a NATO member state, the U.S. is legally obligated, right? That's what the treaty is all about, to defend you, not just the U.S., but all the NATO member countries. Ukraine is a partner, is a formal partner of NATO, but that partnership is mostly rhetorical. It's mostly, you know, things like military trainings or some military assistance, or, you know, NATO and the U.S. also has a partnership with Ukraine separately from that. But most of these are softer things like, you know, diplomacy and aid, and again, military trainings and help with reforming, you know, various ministries. So no, technically, the U.S. would not be obligated to send troops to Ukraine if Russia invades. But if this was a year ago, I would say absolutely not. The U.S. would not do anything. They would just sanction and sort of apply these other mechanisms and look for a diplomatic solution. But the administration says very clearly, and so does the NATO leadership, we're prepared for anything. Again, I really hope we don't come to this, but I still have a hard time seeing the U.S. sending troops to Ukraine in a full-out war with Russia. And, you know, remember, then you've got nuclear powers involved in a kinetic warfare. Again, that would be a complete disaster. But we also have to go back to we have to remember that President Zelensky has not asked NATO or the United States to send troops to Ukraine. What he has been asking is help with negotiations with Russia, and also you help us defend ourselves. We are not asking for your troops. We're asking for your military assistance to help us defend ourselves. So for starters, that's not even on the table at the moment for sort of U.S. military involvement. And again, I have to sort of disagree with many of my colleagues that I still hope that there won't be a full-out invasion.
I think there was reporting last week that China had shown support for Russia. Disastrous outcomes from any shooting war, absolutely. Hopefully it doesn't come to that. Bill Litvin asks about the Budapest memorandum that when Ukraine gave up their nuclear weapons, they wouldn't be attacked by Russia. I think the question just is, what's up with that?
Yeah. And again, it's a matter of interpretation, because Russia says the Budapest memorandum said NATO and Ukraine promised that, you know, NATO would not let Ukraine join its ranks. So Ukraine sees it as, well, Russia promised that it wouldn't invade us. And Russia says, no, you promised you wouldn't join NATO, and NATO promised that they wouldn't, you know, let you in. So this is the trouble with negotiating with her. There's always two versions of reality. Nothing is ever black and white. Look, Moscow just drafted a brand new treaty back in December, right? And wanted NATO to sign it. So it's not even just about sort of looking back at what was promised and agreed upon. It's also now about, no, now we want these new guarantees, new security guarantees from NATO. Let's forget about the past, but this is what we want right now. So that's kind of fascinating, because it's been for a while, Moscow has not been as straightforward about exactly what they wanted, right? So now it's just, we want a written guarantee that you will not, you know, expand into Ukraine.
Two questions about the Nord Stream 2 pipeline from Thomas Schmoyer and Bernard Gerber, just how that comes into play. I actually thought I had seen an article that said it was stopped as a result of this now, but maybe it was just that it was a threat that it would be stopped if there was an invasion. What's the status of that, and how does that come into play with this conflict?
Are we talking about the Nord Stream 2?
Nord Stream 2, yeah.
Yeah, right. So until that's actually really interesting. Again, I think, you know, sometimes people say, you know, why now, right? Because NATO was not getting ready to let Ukraine into its ranks. And, you know, so why is this necessary? Why is this buildup happening now? One of the things to remember is that this is, you know, we just wrapped up President Biden's first year of presidency. I've heard a lot of people say that this could also be, you know, Putin testing Biden to see what kind of a foreign policy he's going to carry out, how far Biden is willing to go to push back Russia. So in April, again, a year ago, it was a couple of months after, so it was in the summer, President Biden actually greenlit Nord Stream 2. He, because the U.S. had been opposing it for a while. It's this gas pipeline from Russia into Germany. So Germany is very much at play here in that situation, and also in Russian energy politics in Europe. But this summer, this past summer, President Biden said that he would support Nord Stream 2. And we saw that as a major concession, as sort of a peace offering to Moscow, because again, that summer, you know, Biden also had calls with Moscow. And that's also when there was this agreement made, you know, there was a Putin-Biden summit, and they actually agreed that they would start working together. They formed a council that would work on arms control, for example. So we saw, you know, Washington's green light of Nord Stream 2 as you know, President Biden's you know, offering of, you know, here, let's work together and I'll let you have Nord Stream 2. Now that's no longer the case, obviously, because Putin either saw that as a weakness or it just wasn't enough for him. So this is now again a part of the sanctions package that Washington would introduce. However, Nord Stream 2 is not as straightforward because, again, we have Germany involved here. And Germany has been very, very reluctant to sort of outright support Ukraine in this situation. So Washington would have to do a lot of diplomatic maneuvering to make sure that Germany is on board with either halting Nord Stream 2 in case of a Russian invasion or completely kill it. But yeah, I think it will be very important to keep an eye on Germany and the rhetoric coming out of there. I'll be going to Munich next week for the Munich Security Summit. So I'll be very interested in hearing what my German colleagues think. But I've heard that, you know, a colleague of mine said that Schröder has a lot of influence still, political influence, and he's obviously very pro-Russian. And that's one of the factors. And the other is Nord Stream 2 / the energy politics between Russia and Germany that keeps Germany so, you know, weary about supporting Ukraine.
And I was mistaken on that headline, at least as of 2 days ago. It was that Biden says no Nord Stream 2 pipeline if Russia invades. So that's still holding, as Bernard had pointed out. It is 1 o'clock. We do have a couple questions still coming in. Do you mind if we keep going a little bit here?
I'm here. I just quickly want to add that the sanctions package that, you know, the sanctions that the Biden administration has discussed, including Nord Stream 2, you know, they're talking about some really fascinating things. Again, we know that sanctions are not really the going to do the trick, because sanctions would happen after the invasion, right? So they're not really going to undo a possible invasion. And, you know, we've seen that they don't really have the kind of effect that we have hoped. But he has, Washington has introduced a couple of sort of extreme ideas, the kinds of sanctions. And again, one of them is, we haven't seen this before, is the idea that they would personally sanction Putin. And then, of course, removing Russia from the international, the SWIFT system would again devastate Moscow. financially.
Yeah, threatening to end Nord Stream 2 feels like a tricky one too, because there are a lot of people going to make money from that. Not all of them just in Russia. So I imagine there'd be some resistance from a lot of places, even from people who support Ukraine to a move like that.
Yeah.
Saul Ash, who we've already heard too from today, president of the World Affairs Council, as says, his question is, Russia ceded Crimea to Ukraine in 1954. What was the reasoning then? And is there an argument for accepting the return now?
Right. Again, I think, you know, this goes back to the disagreements about what Russia considers its own what it believes, what agreements it believes were valid or invalid, right? So I think that we're in a very tricky situation with Crimea. Even in Washington, you'll have people, right, who'll say, oh, well, historically, Crimea was really, really Russia's. So, you know, I mean, that makes sense. However, we live in a modern world, in a rules-based international system that says, you know, one country cannot annex, you know, a legal part of another country, cannot annex another country. Again, this is not it goes against all the international norms, but it's also illegal, right? So whether or not people agree that back whenever, you know, how many ever years ago, Crimea was a part of Russia and it should have never become a part of Ukraine in the first place, that is right now irrelevant, right? The fact is, if the West, you know, sort of walks away from this idea that Russia needs to return Crimea, then we're walking away from, again, some of the fundamental principles of the international rules-based order that we currently have. So it's a very tricky situation, because I personally do not see how Russia would ever hand back Crimea. And yes, President Zelensky. So you've got Donbas first, because it's an active warfare zone. Crimea is sort of a second priority, right? President Zelensky even established this Crimea platform, which is his effort to bring more international players to the negotiating table so that he can find a solution to getting Crimea back. But, you know, I just don't see, unless there's some really major regime change in Russia, unless some, you know, catastrophe happens in Russia and, you know, or catastrophe to Putin, right? And Russia becomes a consolidated democracy and sort of hands back Crimea, right? So it's this a limbo situation with Crimea that I do not see changing anytime soon. I think Donbas is more likely to have a solution than Crimea ever would. So, but it's again, we go back to this challenge to our very, very own identity as you know, a rules-based international global order and a society, right? If you try to solve Crimea by just letting it go to Russia, then you're walking away from some of the founding principles of everything we stand for. So it's
a few things left. Wrap this up for that. Putin wants democracies on his border for fear will want democracy. This is from Deborah.
You were cutting out, so I actually did not completely hear. Can you hear me okay?
Yep, I can hear you just fine. I'll assume
that
I'm back.
Can you repeat that really quickly?
Sure. Is it possible that Putin doesn't want democracies on the border for fear that Russians will want more democracy?
Yeah, of course. When you are an authoritarian leader and a kleptocrat, you're always worried about regime stability. And this goes back to, maybe this is a great, great last question, because I opened with this idea of, we all know what, you know, it's not a mystery what Putin wants. First and foremost, Putin wants power and regime stability. Regime stability is your number one worry when you wake up and when you go to sleep, when you're an authoritarian leader, right? When you're forcefully keeping people down and keeping, you know, quieting dissent, and the space for dissent and, you know, sort of free speech you know, human rights, that space has been closing and closing under Putin to, you know, almost intolerable levels, right? So you cannot expect suppressed people to enjoy living in a closed society for a very long time. And one of the troubles is that, of course, as Russia, the Russians see the outside world and see democracies and also see economic prosperity, they want the same thing. So every year he has to work harder and harder to keep his people down, keep his people quiet. That's why, you know, every time there's an uprising and public protests, although they're fewer and farther in between now, they get bloodier every time. You know, they arrest more people. That's why, you know, Navalny, the main opposition leader and disruptor of the status quo, sits in prison right now. 10 years, I think, was his sentence. So absolutely, yeah, he does not want more democracy. And I would refer everyone to this letter that Russia and China jointly published recently. And it's about, by the way, if anyone was wondering where China stands in all of this, what position China would take, this joint letter that they just published will give you a great insight into that. China very much supports Russia and would be supportive of Russia if there was a full-out war here. But in this, it's really easy to find if you just Google it, but they spend, I don't know, 5 paragraphs talking about democracy. Authoritarian Russia and communist China talked, and it's, you know, published in English, so they're obviously speaking to democracies and, you know, Western countries, about the meaning of democracy, how they respect democracy, and how they have democracy in their countries, and how it's really important, you know, for the West to understand that there's democracy in these countries. They just have their own version of democracy that is mixed with culture and tradition. And how so very important it is for the West not to impose democracy, their version of democracy, on everybody else. So this idea, this meditation about democracy takes a really big chunk, portion of this letter. And that is not an accident, right? They, you know, one of the issues that Russia has had for a really long time with America in particular is our democracy assistance, democracy promotion efforts abroad. And, you know, this is why, you know, Moscow blames the U.S. for orchestrating all the color revolutions in the 2000s in the region, because, you know, how would Ukrainians or Georgians want democracy on their own? It must have been imposed from the West. So yeah, I think democracy is an important factor here, and it's a factor that will be at play for the coming years in Russia's calculus.
I'm going to ask one last question to wrap this up. Hopefully it's fun, but what in your studies and what you see happening, like, is there just like a kind of a fun, interesting fact that like tickles you right now?
Huh. That's a really good question. Well, I don't know. I could share quite a few things, but that is such a good question. I think maybe I would tell you this. Something that I find really fascinating is the country of Moldova. We haven't talked about it too much right now, but, you know, the Black Sea region, right? This is a space right now where you have this rise of authoritarianism, lots of democratic backsliding. And Moldova was a country that until just a couple of years ago was, you know, dominated by the Communist Party. And, you know, its president sat next to Putin at every photo opportunity possible. And, you know, as the crisis in Ukraine deepens, or, you know, Georgia backslides, or, you know, Europe is in this chaos, things like that, there have been, you know, a lot of really good things happening in Moldova. They got rid of, you know, this communist president. So I think if you're looking for maybe a little spark of either optimism or inspiration, if you're interested in Eastern European politics, I would recommend kind of like checking out Moldova, maybe just reading a little bit about it. I'm personally very fascinated by it. And as all these bad things happen, you know, there's this, you know, sort of upward movement in Moldova, and it's kind of going completely flying under the radar because everyone else is, you know, so busy with sort of all the madness elsewhere. So I don't know, this is probably like very not as fun, but maybe if you're sort of really tired of the doom and gloom, something sort of peculiar to look at.
Yeah, I think it will resonate well with our audience. Thank you for sharing that, Maia Otarashvili. Excellent presentation. Thank you for joining me here today. Hopefully we have you back again. Hopefully it's not a worse scenario that we have to discuss. But thanks again. Thanks to everybody on the call who joined. Saul, any final thoughts, closing words? Am I springing it on them? If not, we'll just wrap up.
No, I agree with you. Thank you. Very, very engaging. As Mike can tell, we had our audience staying with you throughout. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks for inviting me.